Hi, everyone. Welcome to the May Random Review. I'm Deborah Goldenberg, and Connie Georgiou and I coordinate this program for the Friends of the Library, which sponsors these events. Connie, would you like to come onto the screen and say hello?
Hello, everyone.
Our library host today is Bonnie Brzozowski, and she'll be moderating the questions at the end of the program. Bonnie, would you like to greet our audience?
Hey, everybody.
If you're having any problems with the GoToWebinar platform, please send us a question and we'll try to help you. We're recording the presentation, so if your issues can't be resolved, you'll find a link to the recording in your follow-up letter and you'll still be able to see the talk. Also, there'll be a link to a more polished version on the Random Review page on the library website soon. On that same page, you can sign up to receive monthly Random Review email announcements and also find a link to a list of library books related to today's topic created by our volunteer, Gail Gerdeman. Also, you can register for the one remaining Random Review for this year on that same page. We encourage you to submit questions for our speaker during or after the talk, and he'll answer as many as we have time for at the end of the program. I'd like to thank our community sponsors, Grassroots Books and Music, Northwest Graphic Imaging, and the Corvallis Gazette Times. And as always, a big thank you to the Best Library, and especially librarians Bonnie Brzozowski and Mike Hansen, who've provided us with excellent support. Next month's review will be on June 8th, when Dr. Michael Nelson, professor in the College of Forestry, will review Braiding Sweetgrass, Indigenous Wisdom, Scientific Knowledge, and the Teachings of Plants by Robin Wall Kimmerer. Now I'd like to invite Marjorie Sandor, author and recent reviewer of the book Hamnet, to introduce today's speaker. Marjorie, would you like to join me on screen? And I'll see you all later. Enjoy.
Thanks, Deborah. And hello, everyone. My name is Marjorie Sandor, and it's a great pleasure for me to introduce my friend and colleague, Keith Scribner, who will be talking today about Ayad Akhtar's novel, Homeland Elegies. Keith and I go way back. 22 years ago, we were lucky to snag him as a new professor in our burgeoning creative writing program at Oregon State. Fresh from a prestigious Jones Fellowship at Stanford, he had just published his debut novel, The Good Life, a harrowing edge-of-your-seat novel and a take on the American dream, to great critical praise. The book was selected for the Barnes & Noble Discover Great Writers series and made the New York Times list of notable books of the year. He arrived in fall 2000 with his wife, the poet Jen Richter, and our luck held. They made Corvallis their home, raised their family here, and have together become an integral part of OSU's creative writing programs, both graduate and undergraduate. Keith went on to publish three more acclaimed novels, Miracle Girl, The Oregon Experiment, and most recently, Old Newgate Road, the winner of the 2020 Connecticut Book Award in Fiction. His stories and essays have appeared in such journals as the New York Times Magazine, The Daily Beast, and American Short Fiction, and in anthologies devoted to flash or very short fiction. He's received both Pushcart and O. Henry Prize honorable mentions for short stories. And another story of his called Level was adapted into an opera, and it premiered at Symphony Space in New York City in May of 2017. Through all of this, Keith has been a devoted and beloved professor of fiction and literature at OSU. His commitment to our students has helped build a thriving literary scene on campus and in Corvallis. And I would be remiss if I didn't confess that I'm always stealing his wisdom and advice to pass along to my own students, and more to the point, to learn from myself. I'm grateful to him, not only for the example of his own work, but for the way he's translated that into practical and truly transformative advice for students and colleagues. You'll get a glimpse today of Keith's intellectual curiosity and savvy, And something else too, the spirit of adventure that comes through in everything he undertakes. Keith is a risk taker in the best sense. Someone who is first and foremost a craftsman and pays close attention to detail, a practice he has honed not only as a writer, but as a woodworker, a vintner, and motorcyclist. It's this mix of craftsmanship and daring that characterizes his writing. He's a fearless explorer of American life, from intimate domestic troubles to complex social terrain, and man, does he know how to get his characters into serious trouble. At the heart of so much of his fiction, and not coincidentally of a wonderful literature course that he has taught at OSU over the years, is the myth of the American dream. This interest dovetails with the themes of the novel he'll be discussing today. He put it to me this way in a recent conversation. Homeland Elegies explores the enduring myths of the American dream and the way notions of American exceptionalism and individualism can pervert the more idealistic visions of the American dream so that it becomes nothing more than a justification for an individual's vast accumulation of wealth at the expense of the common good. While you're letting that sink in, consider a bit of serendipity on the subject of risk taking. I wrote the phrase, Keith is a risk taker, about a week before getting a chance to catch up with him and find out what's on the horizon. I was not fully prepared for his answer. It turns out that in late June, at the beginning of a year-long sabbatical, he'll be setting out on that motorcycle of his, aptly called an adventure bike, on a six-month road trip to Patagonia, taking mostly dirt and gravel back roads and going to the most remote places he can manage. I asked him if some writing might emerge from this trip, and the answer was, of course. And I quote, "I'm not sure what the subject will be yet, but I think it might have something to do with risk." The adventures will continue after that. Keith's most recent novel project, which he's been working on for the last several years, is actually set in Ukraine. During the research project process, he visited that country and fell in love with its people and places, making some very strong personal connections there. When I asked him during our talk about the status of that project, he was frank. He said, "The meaning of Ukraine has changed so much since the war began that the novel doesn't make sense anymore." But his connections there remain strong. Since February 24th, he's been in daily communication with friends in Odessa. And in spring of next year, he's actually scheduled to teach literature at Odessa National University. Let's hope, for everybody's sake, that it's all right and he gets there. And let's be glad he's with us right now before embarking on this extraordinary range of adventures. Please help me welcome Keith Scribner. And Keith, will you join me on screen, please?
Nice, Marjorie, too much. That was lovely. Thank you so much. That was really, really great. And we do go way back, and it's a friendship a sort of partners in crime in terms of teaching and writing that I really, really value and really has meant so much to me during these years. So thank you. And thanks also to Deborah and Connie and Bonnie and the friends at the library for inviting me today to talk about this really great novel, and also for orchestrating this tremendous series, Random Reviews. And thanks to all of you for turning in. I sure wish we could be doing this in person, and I could be seeing you, we could be seeing each other, we could be sharing the space of a room together. Anyway, better days are coming. And I was just thinking, Marjorie, during your introduction about the meaning of Ukraine changing, and yes, and indeed it certainly has. And the meaning, I'd already changed this novel set in Ukraine once when the meaning of Ukraine changed, and that's with the Hunter Biden and Trump and Giuliani fiasco. And I think the meaning, at least to Americans of Ukraine, changed a lot then, and it became something else in our imaginations. And I was able to fold that into the novel in a way that I felt good about it. I think maybe made the novel stronger. But this new change and what Ukraine has come to mean, really just makes the novel not work. And what, so what I was going to say is, as you were saying all those nice things about me, it occurred to me that Homeland Elegies is maybe a novel about the meaning of America. And I don't say that anywhere in my talk, but I think it is. I think it is a novel about what America means, what it means to Americans, what it means. Certainly, he writes pretty explicitly in here about what America means, how the meaning of America has changed, not just in the eyes of Americans, in the eyes of certain Americans, for example, Muslim Americans, but also around the world. And I think we can all, I think that's all apparent to us, especially in the last, say, 6 or 8 years that's happened. So I just want to start by saying, if it's not obvious already, I love this novel. And you, if you haven't read, I hope you've read it. If you haven't read it yet, I really highly recommend that you do. It's incredibly entertaining and smart. The writing is, to use one of Akhtar's similes from the novel's first sentence, as he's describing his brilliant mentor, Mary Maroney, sharp as a German paring knife. The novel's brilliant. Its scope is enormous. There's no way I could begin to wrap my arms around everything here today in the time we have. The human moments are honest and true and deeply moving. A father and son struggling to express their love, a dying mother, romances gone wrong. And the book's social and political commentary on the lasting effects of empires, on the power of debt in America, on the lives of Muslim Americans are utterly eye-opening and convincing. The novel explores the creative process. Akhtar writes about sex and desire, failure and humiliation. He writes beautifully about the experience of drinking exquisite scotch. I'm going to start. Let me first show you. I hope this works. Someone let me know if it doesn't. Here's a picture of the author, Ayad Akhtar. And I'm going to begin by reading what he calls the overture. It's the beginning of the novel. It's, you know, the first line. This is about, it's about 4.5 pages. So I'm going to begin by reading that, this, and I think it'll give you a sense that elegiac, you know, a lot of it, so it's called Homeland Elegies, of course, and a lot of what makes it elegiac is just, is the tone. It has an elegiac tone to it. And I think this overture captures that nicely. And it also sets up much of what I'd like to talk to you about today. By the way, this is right at the beginning. If you have your own book and you want to read along, it's the beginning. And I will say for the other passages that we'll be looking at, I have slides, but since this is 4.5 pages, I'll just read it. I had a professor in college, Mary Maroney, who taught Melville and Emerson, and who the once famous Norman O. Brown, her mentor, called the finest mind of her generation, a diminutive cherubic woman in her early 30s with a resemblance to a Raphaelesque Pluto that was not incidental. Her parents had immigrated from Urbino, a scholar of staggering erudition who quoted as easily from Edas and Hannah Arendt as she did from Moby Dick. A lesbian, which I only mention because she did, often a lecturer whose turns of phrase were sharp as a German paring knife, could score a brain's gray matter and carve out new grooves along which old thoughts would reroute. As on that February morning, 2 weeks after Bill Clinton's first inauguration, when, during a class on life under early American capitalism, Mary, clearly interrupted by her own tantalizing thought, looked up from the floor at which she usually gazed as she spoke, her left hand characteristically buried in the pocket of the loose-fitting slacks that were her mainstay, looked up and remarked almost offhandedly that America had begun as a colony and that a colony it remained. That is, a place still defined by its plunder, where enrichment was paramount and civil order always an afterthought. The fatherland in whose name and for whose benefit the predation continued, was no longer a physical fatherland, but a spiritual one, the American self. Long trained to worship its desires, however discreet, however banal, rather than question them, as the classical tradition taught, ever-tumescent American self-regard was the pillaging patria, she said. And the marauding years of the Reagan regime had only expressed this enduring reality of American life with greater clarity and transparency than ever before. Mary had gotten into some trouble the previous semester for similarly bracing remarks about American hegemony in the wake of Desert Storm. A student in the ROTC program taking her class complained to the administration that she was speaking out against the troops. He started a petition and set up a table in the student union. The brouhaha led to an editorial in the campus paper and threats of a protest that never actually materialized. Mary wasn't cowed. After all, this was the early 90s, and the consequences of astringent ideological fire and brimstone or sexual abuse of power while you're at it were hardly what they are today. If anyone had a problem with what she said that afternoon, I didn't hear about it. The truth is, I doubt many of us even understood what she was getting at. I certainly didn't. Worship of desire, tumescent self-regard, a colony for pillage. In her words, was the power of a great negation, a corrective to the tradition of endless American self-congratulation. It was new to me. I was accustomed to the God-blessed light of the world exceptionalism that informed every hour I'd ever spent in history class. I'd come of age in an era of the hilltop city gleaming for all to see. Such were the glorified tropes I learned at school, which I saw not as tropes, but as truth. I saw an American benevolence in Uncle Sam's knowing glare at the post office, heard an American abundance in the canned laugh tracks on the sitcoms I watched every night with my mother. I felt an American security and strength as I pedaled my 10-speed Schwinn past split-level and two-story homes in the middle-class subdivision where I grew up. Of course, my father was a great fan of America back then. To him, there was no greater place in the world, nowhere you could do more, have more, be more. He couldn't get enough of it, camping in the Tetons, driving through Death Valley, riding to the top of the arch in St. Louis before hopping a riverboat down to Louisiana to fish for bass on the bayou. He loved visiting the historic sites. We had framed our photos of trips to Monticello and Saratoga and to the house on Beale Street in Brookline where the Kennedy brothers were born. I recall a Saturday morning in Philadelphia when I was 8 and father scolding me for whining through a crowded tour of rooms somehow connected with the Constitution. When it was over, we took a cab to the famous steps at the museum and he raced me to the top, letting me win. In homage to Rocky Balboa. Love for America and a firm belief in its supremacy, moral and otherwise, was creed in our home, one my mother knew not to challenge, even if she didn't quite share it. Like both Mary's parents, as I would learn later from Mary herself, my mother never found in the various bounties of her new country anything like the sufficient compensation for the loss of what she'd left behind. I don't think mother ever felt at home here. She thought Americans materialistic and couldn't understand what was so holy about the orgy of acquisition they called Christmas. She was put off that everyone always asked where she was from and never seemed bothered that they had no idea what she was talking about when she told them. Americans were ignorant not only of geography, but of history too. And most troubling to her was what she thought connected to this disregard of important things, namely the American denial of aging and death. This last irritation would yield a malevolent concretion over the years, a terror-inducing bête noire that saw her to her grave, the thought that growing old here would mean her eventual sequestering and expiration in a home that was nothing like one. My mother's views, however rarely voiced, should have prepared me to understand Mary's dyspeptic take on this country, but they didn't. Not even my Islam prepared me to see what Mary saw, not even after 9/11. I remember a letter from her in the months following that terrifying day in September that changed Muslim lives in America forever. A 10-page missive in which she encouraged me to take heart, to learn what I could from the trouble ahead, confiding that her struggle as a gay woman in this country, the sense of siege, the unceasing assault on her quest for wholeness, the roughness of her route to autonomy and authenticity, that all these had been but fires beneath her crucible, provoking creative rage, tempering sentimentality, releasing her from hope in ideology. Use the difficulty, make it your own, was her admonition. Difficulty had been the flintstone against which her powers of analysis were sharpened, the how and why of what she saw, but which I still wouldn't see truly with my own eyes for 15 years to come, my deepening travails as a Muslim in this country notwithstanding. No, I wouldn't see what Mary saw until I'd been witness to the untimely decline of a generation of colleagues, exhausted by the demands of jobs that never paid them enough, drowning in debt to care for children riddled with disorders that couldn't be cured, and the cousins and the best friends from high school who ended up in shelters or on the street, tossed out of homes they could no longer afford, and until the near dozen suicides and overdoses of 40-something childhood classmates in a mere space of 3 years. And the friends and family medicated for despair, anxiety, lack of affect, insomnia, sexual dysfunction, and the premature cancers brought on by the chemical shortcuts for everything from the food moving through our irritable bowels to the lotions applied to our sun-poisoned skins. I wouldn't see it until our private lives had consumed the public space, then been codified, foreclosed, and put up for auction, until the devices that enslave our minds had filled us with the toxic flotsam of a culture no longer worthy of the name, until the bright pliancy of human sentience, attention itself, had become the world's most prized commodity. The very movements of our minds transformed into the streams of unceasing revenue for someone somewhere. I wouldn't see it clearly until the American self had fully mastered the plunder, idealized and legislated the splitting of the spoils, and brought to near completion the wholesale pillage not only of the so-called colony, how provincial a locution that seems now, but also of the very world itself. In short, I wouldn't see what she saw back then until I'd failed at trying to see it otherwise, until I'd ceased believing in the lie of my own redemption, until the suffering of others aroused in me a starker, clearer cry than any anthem to my own longing. I read Whitman first with Mary. I adored him, the green leaves and dry leaves, the spears of summer grass, the side curved head, ever avid for what came next. My tongue too is homegrown, every atom of this blood formed of this soil, this air. But these multitudes will not be my own, and these will be no songs of celebration. All right, I wish I'd written that myself. And I hope you get can hear the elegiac tone of this novel from the start. He does so much work, and I'll refer back to that overture a little bit as we're going through. He does so much work to set up the novel in those 4.5 pages. A little bit on his biography. Ayad Akhtar was born in Staten Island to Pakistani immigrant parents, both medical doctors, and he grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, studied theater and religion at Brown University, and got an MFA in film directing from Columbia. His first novel, American Dervish, is a coming-of-age story about a Pakistani-American boy growing up in Milwaukee. His first produced play, Disgraced, won many awards, including the 2013 Pulitzer Prize for Drama. In Disgraced, an American-born, Muslim-raised lawyer, a rising star in his Manhattan law firm, admits to his friends that he felt a, quote, blush of pride after the attacks on September 11th. I mention this detail about Akhtar's play because those of you who've already read Homeland Elegies will begin to see just how closely the main character of the novel Homeland Elegies, Ayad Akhtar, resembles the novel's author, Ayad Akhtar. But it's a novel. It says so right on the cover. Homeland Elegies stretches the definition of a novel. It's told in the form of a memoir by a Staten Island-born, Milwaukee-raised playwright whose biography is nearly identical to everything I've said so far about the author. This mining of material from his real life is in every aspect of the book. His father was indeed a successful cardiologist who celebrated American capitalism and opportunity and was happy to have left Pakistan and Islam behind. Whereas his mother never felt she fully belonged in the U.S. and her whole life pined to return to the culture, religious life, and community of the Pakistani homeland that she felt defined her. It would take all of our time here to start listing the autobiographical elements in this novel. And I'll just add that Akhtar has remained tight-lipped about some of the juicier details of the novel, such as whether his father was indeed Donald Trump's heart doctor in the 90s. And more of these details will come up during my talk. But for now, let's just suffice it to say that this novel, again, told in the form of a memoir in the first person I, is a sort of memoir. We could call it autofiction. Akhtar isn't just borrowing from his real life for his fiction, as nearly all fiction writers do, but he's constantly reminding us in that, reminding us in the book that he's doing it. Take this passage from a scene in which Ayad, and I'm going to try to refer to the novel's narrator as Ayad and its author as Akhtar, since they share a name. He's just admitted to his Pakistani-American girlfriend that for 3 months after 9/11, he wore a crucifix, which achieved exactly what he'd hoped it would. Let's just say I didn't have any trouble until after I took it off. That's when the dirty look started. More stuff like what happened at the hospital. I mean, the usual, the tense looks, the double takes, the old ladies worried when they see me on the bus or the subway, the shit people say under their breath. Ayad acquires the cross and puts it on after he's threatened by a white man in line at a blood donation site set up in front of a hospital in Lower Manhattan on September 11th. "We don't want your Arab blood," the man shouts, and yet it gets worse from there, the threats escalating to the point where Ayad loses control of his bladder and feels deep humiliation. But here's the passage I was getting to. After he tells his girlfriend, Asa, about wearing the cross for 3 months, Akhtar is reminding us of the memoirist in this narrative. Asa was quiet, but her guarded look wasn't hard for me to read. If I was calmer, dear reader, I would recast that expression on her face, offer an airbrushed look of offense as a prelude to a vociferous objection on her part, then follow it with a concocted back and forth that made clear her Muslim horror over the attacks, no different in kind from that of any non-Muslim. And I'll just interject here, that concocted back and forth seems to even suggest he feels that there's a certain dishonesty to fictionalizing his experience, and he needs to present it here as a memoirist. If I cared less about it all, I would write it like that to save myself the likely grief ahead, but I won't write it that way because that's not what happened. So, Homeland Elegies is a novel about belonging and dispossession, especially for Muslim Americans in a post-9/11 world. In Scranton, Pennsylvania, after an encounter, first with a state trooper who's suspicious of Ayad's dark skin and Egyptian name, against his better judgment, Ayad explains to the trooper why his Pakistani parents gave him an Egyptian name. and then a second encounter with the trooper's unscrupulous auto mechanic nephew. He tells us, I was lost and broke and felt persistently humiliated and under attack in the only country I'd ever known, a place that the more I understood, the less I felt I belonged. It would be another hour before I got to the Scranton city limits, but by then my mind would be made up. I was going to stop pretending that I felt like an American. He is an American. He says he's an American. America is his home, but he no longer feels like an American. You see, we Muslims lived in a Christian land. That's how we saw it, at least in the families I knew. We lived in a Christian land, but we didn't understand it. We didn't respect it. But here was the paradox. In order to flourish in this new land, we had to adopt its Christian ways, ways that befuddled us and that we disdained, ways we saw reflected in almost every aspect of American life. It might be hard for a non-Muslim American, an agnostic or atheist, for secular humanists to understand the perspective I'm describing, in which a soul signifier, Christian, is used to stand in for the totality of American life. And note the hesitation on we Muslims. Ayad himself is not a practicing or observant Muslim, but like the blurring of narrator and author, the referent of the collective pronoun we is often blurred or confused in scene after scene, leaving even the characters themselves wondering, does we refer to immigrants or Muslims or all Americans or Arabs or Christians? Teasing out central questions in the book about identity and belonging and how the definition of American, our collective we, can be so different for different people. The book also, of course, is an elegy, or really a series of elegies, to America, to Pakistan, to lost romances, lost loves, to his mother and her lost Pakistan, to the love she never fulfilled with Latif, the man she always wished she'd married instead of Ayad's father. Latif becomes more deeply religious, practicing medicine in the US, and returns to Pakistan, where the CIA bankrolls his clinic with the agreement that he'll treat wounded Mujahideen soldiers from over the border, and then withdraws its support when the Russians leave Afghanistan, at which point Latif becomes radicalized and the CIA assassinate him. By her bedside as she's dying, Ayad tells us the most vibrant of my childhood memories were those of life in my father's village and of the interlocking rooms in my mother's family's sprawling Rawalpindi bungalow. I loved being there, but I never pined for it when we returned, not like she did. As a young boy, I often remarked how much happier she was when we were in Pakistan. I used to pray to God for her to be happy like that in America too. I was happy you were happy, Mom. It was nice to be with family. I never really liked it here, she said, and then added, you're one of them now. Write about them. Don't write about us. The book is an elegy to the lives of Americans lost on 9/11 and to all the possibilities that vanished for Muslim Americans on that horrific day. It's a father-son story, and Ayad's elegy to the loss of his father and his father's embrace of the American dream as understood by Robert Bork and Donald Trump. There's a signed copy of The Art of the Deal in their living room. It's a book about immigration, or really migration, exile, empires, and colonies. A book of social, religious, cultural, and political commentary. And I just mentioned Bork, the long sections in which he and another character are discussing Bork's profound effect on America and our notion of of individual, especially individual financial and economic rights, despite not getting on the Supreme Court, it's really smart, and it works, and what's so amazing to me is you don't lose pace with the story, with the drama, with the novel, with the characters, as we read these things. A book of social, religious, cultural, and political commentary. We can read the book as a series of essays. I know this isn't a great slide, but you can see that many of the chapters' titles even mimic essay titles on autobiography or Bin Laden, on love and death. Montaigne, usually considered the inventor of the essay, is referenced several times in the narrative by name. These essays are delivered both in narrative exposition, that is straight from the character of Ayad, like soliloquies, and that's something else, but another form the novel takes, but also sometimes in dialogue, as characters explicitly discuss and debate these issues. Footnotes are used, sometimes for an aside, but more often to contextualize Muslim practices, beliefs, terminology, or rituals, as if to reinforce how non-Muslim readers need short primers throughout this novel if we're ever to understand the stories of these other Americans, which is to say, if we're ever to understand ourselves, us, we Americans. And notice again in the table of contents that the novel opens with an overture, as in a symphony, or I think more fittingly, an opera. The chapters resonate like songs or movements, and we end with a coda. Through the pages, he often refers to the many stories thrumming through the novel as songs. Homeland Elegies also has elements of a stage play, most noticeably the courtroom scene in chapter 8, presented on the page as a play. This is the malpractice trial that ends Ayad's father's medical career. The sleazy corporate lawyer who should be overseeing his defense instead settles with the plaintiff because of an act of terrorism committed by a Muslim man, coincidentally in the trial's final days, that the lawyer calculates could sway the jury against Dr. Akhtar, and more important to the lawyer, against the medical corporation that employs Dr. Akhtar, Ayad's father. This lawyer's nickname is that iconic symbol of American wholesomeness, Quaker Oats. I haven't stopped at every moment that there's something that is actually true from Akhtar's life, but that is one of them. His father, quite a successful cardiologist, his career ended with a malpractice suit. Like any thoughtful story about the American dream, Homeland Elegies explores the myth versus the reality of that promise. Here's the description of the courtroom where the play that you're seeing will be acted out, a trial in which everyone agrees the science is on Dr. Akhtar's side. The chamber had nothing even vaguely ennobling about it. No vaulted ceiling, no Greek columns to remind us of the birth of democracy. There was no mahogany finish or railed balcony for onlookers, not an echo of Maycomb or a hint of that soundstage replica of the New York court where three decades of rightful justice were meted out by the hour on Law and Order. The wood on the walls didn't look real, though it was broad maple planks finished with a sickly yellow varnish. No one sat upright, not the jury, not the plaintiffs or their lawyers, not my father or those few of us like me looking on. We were all sinking into our scooped out seat bottoms, our buckling spines chilled by the steady whisper of cold air trickling down through the vents above us. At one point, I started to wonder if this was what it would feel like to be trapped in the crisper drawer of a fridge, by any measure, hardly a place to battle for one's reputation. By the way, there's a lot of humor in the book, too. Quiet envelops the audience, the lights dim, the curtain rises, and then the play opens. this image of justice, this image of what American justice is, certainly has lots of basis in reality, but also is perpetuated by, for example, Law and Order, by Hollywood. And that this trial of Ayad's father, which is hardly could be called justice, given what we're told in the novel, plays out in a setting that's more fitting for a miscarriage of justice. Homeland Elegies is also a reflection on writing, and the novel is full of this, all of this really, I think, really inspiring, insightful scenes and dialogue and action about writing, the writing life, writing discipline and practice, as well as other arts, certainly plays. Ayad reflects explicitly on how to transform his own experience into art. As I hope I've demonstrated, the whole book is precisely that. Like most writers, Ayad struggles with how to write about his own family. His father's extremely anxious about how his son will portray him. And I did read just a little bit of an interview in which Ayad talks about, everyone asks him about why he's blurring the lines with the memoir. And he speaks about by writing a straight memoir, he didn't feel he'd be making a metaphor of his own experience. And that's part of, for him, that's part of what this means to not just write autobiographical fiction and not write a memoir, but to do what he's done, where he goes much further in terms of blurring the lines. And this hope that's how you make your own experience rise to the level of art, and that's by making metaphor out of your own experience, and also that's how it is most meaningful to the most people. Lots of reviewers talk about the urgency of this book. Reviewers love to talk about the urgency of books. I think this one does have real urgency, and also I think Akhtar himself felt there was urgency and felt it was essential that he tell the story in a way that reached people, maybe also because he wanted a lot of readers, but because he felt what he had to say was important, essential. Homeland Elegies, and he's also navigating how to write about America and Islam, as well as write about himself. Ayad mentions Philip Roth as one of his favorite writers, Roth, who was accused of portraying Jews in a poor light. I haven't gone back to read it yet since I read this novel, but American Pastoral, Roth's American Pastoral, probably one of my favorites, top 25 list, and I think makes a great companion with this novel. And I'm going to read it soon, and sort of side by side with this book. Akhtar invokes Salman Rushdie in the Satanic Verses and expresses his own fear of retribution from the mullahs. This comes in a wonderful flashback early in the book when Ayad, still a college student, meets with his aunt Asma, who has lots to tell her nephew about books and becoming a writer. She raves about Jane Austen and Edward Said. Of course, before you read reader writes another word, you must read Edward Said. What a brilliant man and gorgeous. He moved like a leopard. I met him at a conference 10 years ago. If I hadn't been married, Beta, what I would have done to get into that bedroom. Anything. Edward's book is indispensable, Ayad. There are very few books you can say that about, but Orientalism is one. You won't know who you are until you've read it. Whatever you think you are now, when you finish that book, you will be something different. When he tells her he's reading Rushdie, she says, Midnight's Children? Brilliant book, just brilliant. But she's horrified when he tells her it's actually Satanic Verses. the sickening ad hominem attacks on the prophet, peace be upon him, picking through that disgusting Orientalist history, disgusting tales the Christians told to make the prophet out as some sex-crazed cult leader, God forbid. I mean, this is what we have to expect from Salman, from one of us. I'm trying to read it as well as he does. I listened to some of this. I listened to some of the books on tape, and the library has audio version of this. It brought so much when I went back and read it again to prepare this talk. It brought so much to the book to have read it, to have listened to him read it. He reads it himself. It's not an actor. He's a former actor himself. Perhaps still he's acting some. And he brings so much to these scenes and the voices. And of course, he does the accents very well. It's his own family. He's imitating. And I really recommend, if you're someone who likes to listen to audiobooks, I recommend this one a lot. One of the best I've ever listened to. This flashback is followed by a passage in which Ayad reflects on what it's like for him to consider writing about Islam. He says, "When I do write about Islam, I will attempt it without an ounce of malice and may still not survive its publication. For now, let me try to stay alive and just say these three things. As Muslims, we are more affected by the example of the Prophet than we realize. We are shaped by the stories we tell about him in ways that elude our daily understanding. And there will be no meaningful philosophical shift in the socio-political substratum of the Muslim world until the example of the Prophet and the text of the Quran are exposed to a more robust interrogation of their claims to historical truth. This may all sound both reasonable and surprising to you, non-Muslim readers, and may strike some of you Muslim readers as uncomfortably close to the sorts of calls for reformation of the faith that so many have found historically ignorant at best, mortally insulting at worst. And yet the fact that I can barely say it all without some fear of reprisal is, ignorance and insulting notwithstanding, a true measure of how far we Muslims have to go." The novel is also an exploration of the unconscious, of dreams, intuition, astrology, and psychics, uncanny knowing. 2 days before 9/11, Ayad dreamed of an attack on Manhattan. These many moments in the book blur the lines between what's known and what's imagined, between perception and reality. Asa's psychic tells her she's going to meet Ayad. As a little boy, Ayad had a dream, has an imaginary friend who seems to be the ghost of his dead brother he was never told existed. Dreams and astrology foretell events. All of this leads us back to Akhtar's choice to blend fiction and memoir. This is not only a post 9/11 story, but a story written during the Trump years. Akhtar is consciously blurring our understanding, what's real, what's a composite, what's knowable, what's exaggerated or fabricated, giving us a novel for the post-truth world. If you've read the book, you know this, and if you haven't, you probably have gathered by now, the book jumps all around in time to tell its many stories. In his memoir's voice, he often directly addresses the reader about these time jumps. A rondo, then, whose recurring leading theme leaves my aunt Asma dangling mid-thought and drops us now in Abbottabad for its culminating recapitulation. The year is 2008. In that spirit, I'm going to take us back to the beginning, to the overture to America and the novel's opening line. I had a professor in college, Mary Maroney, who taught Melville and Emerson, and who the once famous Norman O. Brown, her mentor, called the finest mind of her generation, a diminutive cherubic woman in her early 30s with a resemblance to the Raphaelesque Puto that was not incidental. Her parents had immigrated from Urbino, a scholar of staggering erudition who quoted as easily from the Edas and Hannah Arendt as she did from Moby Dick. The novel's first sentence runs nearly a page, but this is enough to see some of the ideas and images Akhtar is setting up with his overture to America, beginning with references to two of our foundational American thinkers and writers, Melville and Emerson, references to Christianity with the Raphaelesque Puto and Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as Moroni, the prophet of Mormonism, our own homegrown American Christianity. And finally, I'll skip 4.5 pages ahead to the end of the overture, where he invokes the poet and the poem that are often considered that singular voice of what it means to be an American, Song of Myself. I read Whitman first with Mary. I adored him, the green leaves and dry leaves, the spears of summer grass, the side curved head ever avid for what came next. My tongue too is homegrown, every atom of this blood formed of this soil, this air. But these multitudes will not be my own, and these will be no songs of celebration. This passage borrows directly from Whitman's Song of Myself, in which the poem's speaker says, "My tongue, every atom of my blood formed from this soil, this air." But the poem also says, "For every atom belonging to me, as good belongs to you." Although Whitman begins the poem with, "I celebrate myself and sing myself," he's not speaking about himself as an individual, but he's speaking for all of us. It's a democratic poem that invites all kinds of different people into that voice, that I, in order to unify us. "It is you talking," the poem says, "just as much as myself. I act as the tongue of you." And of course, the very famous line, "I contain multitudes." Homeland Elegies is not only a post-9/11 novel, but it was written during the Trump years. And though it moves all over in time, Trump's election and presidency are where time is centered in the book. As Akhtar wrote the novel, he feared the country was moving in exactly the opposite direction than Whitman celebrates in his poem. America fragmented, the collective we meaningless. The American dream is not about the unity, equality, and brotherly love that Whitman celebrates, but the paramount right of the individual to accumulate money regardless of its effect on the common good. Citizens become consumers, human fulfillment is measured in dollars. The novel trains Akhtar's perceptive eye on America, the good and the bad, and concludes, "For better, for worse, and it's always a bit of both. I don't want to be anywhere else. I've never thought about it. I've never even thought about it. America is my home." I'll stop there. Thanks for listening. I hope we have a little time to, I'll invite Bonnie back, and I hope we have a little time to consider some of you, I'll do my best to try to answer some of your questions.
Yeah, thanks, Keith. That was really wonderful, really fascinating. I haven't read the book myself, so you definitely gave me some inspiration for wanting to read it. I do have a question from Anthony. It's a little lengthy. Question for Keith about the form of the novel. Within a short time, Homeland Elegy, Shuggy Bain, and the Topeka School were published, and each of them were fictionalized treatments of their life and experiences. I greatly enjoyed the tension in the question, how much of this actually happened to the author? Because of the art of the novelist, it ultimately doesn't matter to the reader. Any comment about the timing and approach of these novels by these novelists?
I wonder if, you know, what I was saying toward the end, I wonder if they all were recognizing, little bit of an interview that I read, Akhtar again addresses this and says that this is what made sense for especially for the Trump years, is this notion of that we were beyond truth, and that what was that fiction in news was just as interesting or important or credible as nonfiction in news, and that for a novel to he even said something in this thing like trying to get the attention of readers who are living in that world. Well, how do you do that? Well, you do the same thing yourself. And so it requires that kind of, to write a novel that really evoked the time required reflecting the time. So I guess that's the best I can say, that's why it's no coincidence that those three books would come out all together.
Yeah, I think you're right. That's really interesting. Thanks for that. We also have a question from Melissa. It's a little bit similar, but I'll ask anyways. Was the mix of memoir fiction, was that distracting at all? Did you step out of the book to wonder what the character experienced and if the author did too?
So let's see. The author steps out at times, like that very first passage I read, where he said, I think it was the first passage, where he, or second maybe, where he says, you know, I should be a lot easier on me if I change things a little, but I'm not going to do that. And so he does step out, but it's all, of course, all part of reminding us that of exactly what he's doing. So let's see. So no, it didn't distract me. I thought it was kind of fun. I guess it made me curious. I do wonder if his father was actually Donald Trump's, doctor. I do wonder if, Ayad Akhtar had syphilis and actually brought his father, the doctor, out to the garage to confirm that he had syphilis. And so we all wonder about those things. And I guess, I mean, finally, the answer is no. I found that all it did was kind of make me a little more curious and make me, again, I think make me do what he wants us to do, which is to sort of in a social media way, kind of get curious about juicy things.
Yeah. Sure. I want to open it up to anybody else who has a question for us. Please submit. Because that's all I've got for right now, but I want to give it, you know, just another minute in case somebody's typing in. I love his mix of the different formats, like the play versus the essay titles and mm-hmm. all of that.
Yeah, it's great. And he does that with the formats, and it's not quite, I mean, I considered calling it a sort of a collage format, and really it's not. I mean, it's mostly pretty straight narrative, but he's constantly bringing little bits of something else in. The footnotes are, I think the footnotes are really well used. And that's another place where, you know, where there's so much of his own life in it, with his own successful plays. In fact, what they were about, I mean, exact lines from his own play become a play that this character wrote, and there's some real and moving, like, I have no idea if this is true, but what he comes to in the novel is that he got that sort of blush of pride actually ends up coming from his mother. So where did he get that line? Where did he get that line? Well, he got that line from his mother and put it in the play. And so he, these things don't just sort of pop up on their own. They all trace back into the story and the characters.
Interesting. Thank you. While we were chatting, we did get a few more questions. Michelle says, not exactly a question, but she saw his play at the Majestic Theater a couple of years ago, and it was very thought-provoking and unsettling. Did you happen to see that play?
No, I wish I had, but I didn't. And I know I've only read about it. And actually, I watched some clips on YouTube also. And it is thought-provoking and unsettling for sure. Yeah. I think I might have read too. It was one of the most produced plays in America one year or a couple of years. Yeah.
Wow.
Pretty amazing, actually.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And then another question from Melissa. In the audiobook, how does he manage speaking the play sections clearly?
Yeah, he just does it. I'm trying to remember if he does the voice with his family members. He does the voices, and the voices are amazing. And he also does women voices really well, and which is not always the case with audiobooks, where especially a man trying to do a woman's voice, it just never comes off. And so he does that all really well. I think in the play, he sort of does it straight, kind of like a play, a reading of a play, you know, where actors aren't actually acting, but just reading the play. So, and he just says the name, and it began, it's very clear. And there's little bits of stage direction in those pages, which are italicized and which just through his voice he does. He's pretty incredible guy. I mean, I'd love to see him act in something. I know you can see him in some movies, but he, I'm so impressed with the writing and with the delivery and with the energy of the writing. And just with his whole being as a creative, as a maker of creative things, I'm kind of intimidated by, but also inspired by.
Sure. And then it is just one, but I think this is a good question to end on. So let's go ahead and do this last one. Michelle asks, they're thinking of adding this title to their book club title list. What do you think about this title for a book club? Think it would be good fodder?
Oh, great. Yeah, absolutely. Because, I mean, the only hard thing will be trying to settle on what to talk about. I mean, you could spend the whole time talking about form, as I think I mostly did. You could spend the whole time talking about exile. There's enough in this book, really. You know, you could spend 2 hours just talking about exile, just talking about imperialism, just talking about the sex scenes, frankly. And what, you know, sort of what's going, I mean, sex scenes, of course, are never just about the sex, right? I mean, that's like the definition of gratuitous sex, is that they're only about the sex. So they're always about something else. And what that something else is, I think is, I haven't actually read about this at all, but I'm sure there's some reviewers are critical of him for, I don't know, certain expressions of male sexuality in this. So yes, I'm thumbs up. I think it's a great, great, great book for a book club. Yes.
Awesome. Thank you. And then with that, I'd like to invite everybody back on screen and just to say goodbye to everyone. Thank everyone for spending your time with us this afternoon. Hi, everybody.
Here we are.
Thanks again to all of you for asking me to do this, and Marjorie for that wonderful introduction. I really appreciate it.
Awesome talk.
And I'd like to thank Keith for that wonderful review. It was terrific. And thank Marjorie for her brilliant introduction. It was great. And Bonnie and Connie too. So thank you all. And thank you all for coming. And we hope to see you next time in about a month. Take care, everyone.
See you then.
Thank you, everyone.
Have a good afternoon.